My name is Adam Roosevelt, and I am honored to serve all of you, our country, and work alongside the American citizens who dedicate their lives to preserve the fabric of our democracy. Today, I will be addressing today's frontier on cyber warfare and its impact on election security and its impact on energy infrastructure security. I will first start by saying the age of cyber warfare is here. I am a former U.S. military member. My experience includes working with NATO forces on cybersecurity, supporting various nations and our coalition partners in Europe, as well as in Afghanistan deployed during wartime. I have trained with the NATO forces. I've worked alongside the Italian military, the Turkish forces. I've worked with the Bulgarian, the Canadian, and other various NATO partners, and also have advised at the Ministry of Defense level during wartime. Important to note, to date, I am actually a C-suite executive for my own corporation, which is known as AR International Consulting, LLC, and I have experience supporting various clients as a subject matter expert across a numerous fields, cyber, policy, joint operation, senior management, and I am well versed in the affairs that aim to advance multiple efforts across the federal, state, and our local governments. Let me start with this disclaimer. There are many things that we need to talk about, but this is my individual thoughts, and I am not acting in any official capacity. Simply put, I am speaking as a free American citizen. Okay, let's pull back the Iron Curtain on these issues. The first topic I want to get into with the American people today is election security. A lot is going on Capitol Hill. We're talking about these issues, but let's get right into the meat of it. Election security, meaning the protection of the fabric of our election processes, which, as we all know, has been the bedrock of democracy for decades. To start with a few points of clarification, there are about 50 states who rely on the security of our election process because it shapes, as you all know, the direction of our nation. Remember, there are many adversaries out there, such as Iran and other foreign organizations that aim to always impact the particular direction of our country. It's important that we note this. Remember, these adversaries have sought to degrade the faith in democratic values and institutions, interrupt election integrity, and spread misinformation campaigns to persuade various American voter blocs. If a nation will fight on the battlefield, why would they not engage from the digital domain? My point. It was democracy that we fought for, and it will be democracy that continues to shape how our nation proceeds in its election processes for the next hundreds of years. We've never faced a threat of this magnitude or even this level of complexity where an adversary can actually, from hundreds of miles away, change votes from a single computer. This is something that we need to address. It is, I believe, safe to say that every generation is faced with new challenges. I think we can all agree on that. But every generation must face them head on and with the same courage and dedication as their predecessor generations. Today, my personal opinion, if you ask me, is that the political climate in America today has become so toxic that to discuss various critical issues facing our country, many will attribute that discussion to some plan to say that an election was illegitimate. This address, we're not here for that. We are here to simply address the critical topics that are facing our nation today. If we are to be American, we must focus on one, protecting the fabric of our country, and that is the right to vote without interference from any non-American adversaries who, as we know, will wish to harm the very fabric of our nation that many of us went to war for. So here are some facts. Election security, many of you have been informed, is now considered critical infrastructure. That's right next to energy, that's right next to nuclear reactors, that's right next to the defense industrial base, and more. So hundreds of thousands of people who collectively voted their candidate into office, that candidate, now elected official, may have assisted with the critical infrastructure designation for election security and thought it was fairly important. So I would agree and say, yes, that's pretty important. And put that in context, I'm sure you can agree. I swore an oath of allegiance to the United States and everything that comes along with it. Freedom of speech, freedom of press, freedom of religion, and there's more. Great constitutional values to stand up for. Many of you out there would have stand next to me and stand right next to our American flag and feel the same way. So I'll continue to serve my country by defending those values because it has always been the right thing to do as an American. And you should have that pride in your country as an American citizen. I, for one, am an American dad. I'm committed to this task for my daughter, her children, and their children's children, who are counting on you and I, as Americans, to do the right thing and to protect our country. So, if it is fear you have today when you address these issues, look in the mirror and remember this. The blueprint of democracy is you, and always has been you. You don't need to be rich. You don't need to be an elected official, or even have the governor on speed dial. All you need is the courage that is already in your DNA from the same cloth of our founding fathers. On a more direct note, here are some pointed facts that you should know. The United States government, from my opinion, has already initiated the effort to get ahead of election security through various policy directives from the White House, such as the Presidential Policy Directive 21, which is actually the Critical Infrastructure Security and Resilience, PPD. There's also the Executive Order 13800, which is strengthening the cybersecurity of federal networks and critical infrastructure and more. Policy is, I would say, a part of the effort to secure elections. However, I would say that this is a small part. It will take a more collaborative approach to stay ahead of these emerging threats that are emerging and impending on current today's national security and economic security. So let's get involved in this right now. I would say right today that today's elections are decentralized. And here's a fact that you should know. There are about 8,000 jurisdictions across the 50 states, across the United States, that are responsible for the administration of our election process. Under United States Code Title 52, which is the voting and elections, each state is required to designate a state officer or employee as the chief state election official. I think that's pretty good information to know. Some resources that are available to each state are the MSISAC, which I'm hoping a lot of folks have been informed, but for this discussion, the MSISAC is the Multi-State Information Sharing and Analysis Center. It supports the state and local, territorial, and tribal governments with improving their cybersecurity posture. Now, the states are on a volunteer basis. However, I would say I encourage each state to participate or provide an independent vetted program that raises the bar. This is about raising the bar for security to protect our critical infrastructure. Next, I would say partner with the Election Security Task Force, partner with the U.S. Election Assistance Commission, and partner with DHS to get ahead of these issues and receive the most up-to-date information. Let's talk about a scenario I read about in the MSISAC documentation. It's online. You can read it. You can pull it out yourself regarding elections. Scenario one. Suppose a nation state uses the internet to access and disrupt one or more of the state's voter registration databases such that legitimately registered voters are denied the ability to vote on election day or are required to file, as you all know, a provisional ballot. I've been an election official before. I've been out there at the polls, so I know it's very difficult but a very serious process. If that is to happen, here are the consequences. From an optics perspective, a news story gets released in the United States and becomes an election integrity talking point, which impacts how the American people feel about their future elections and the outcome of those elections, and on the second hand, slows down the voting process, which discourages U.S. voters to vote on the premise that elections are not secure. Don't believe it can't happen? Here's some more information on the three classes of election systems. Let's start with class one. Class one, network-connected systems and components that are actually reachable from the web or via remote management. That's the first class. Class 2, there are election systems that are indirectly connected systems, not connected to the network at any time, however, comma, they may become reachable when they need to exchange information with other election system components that are actually connected to the network. Continuing forward, the last class, if you should all know, the non-digital elections components, such as the paper ballots and etc. So those are the three classes. But as we begin to modernize our IT infrastructure across the state and in local and cities, we must ensure that we streamline processes that will ensure we are posturing ourselves for risk mitigation. That is very important. We have to address these current and emerging threats. Now, that's a high level on election security. I will be addressing the more advanced discussion in later addresses. We're working on that now, so if you have any questions, please let me know. But let's transition into the next topic, energy infrastructure security. There has always been the table talk with family, friends at the table about some nation state being able to take down the United States grid. Well, here's my personal thoughts. These are my personal thoughts. The entire grid, not possible. I would say different parts of the grid is a discussion for the experts. Here's some facts. 80% of the country's energy infrastructure sector is actually owned by the private sector. We, the private sector, tend to be more prepared and advanced versus the public sector. There's nothing wrong with that, to my opinion. This is generally due to the red tape and burdensome processes, which I would say, let's cut regulation. However, let's be smart about cutting regulation so that it does not impact health and quality of life. Per my understanding today, the energy infrastructure is divided into three segments. That's electricity, oil, and natural gas. In many cases, these sectors use industrial control systems, or they use what's called SCADA, which is known as the Supervisory Control and Data Acquisition Systems architecture that allow for remote management and access from the internet. To some degree, there is security to combat open access from the web. As I assess it today, all sectors do rely on electric power, even you, the consumer. Let's talk about that. The iPhone you use to call Uber, the coffee pot when you wake up in the morning and you've got to get a quick rush, your GPS applications, Google Maps, and even the grocery store American mothers and American fathers go to in order to buy infant formula and family goods. To date, we rely on the National Infrastructure Protection Plan for risk management in these sectors, similar to the NIST risk management framework. Some of you ISOs out there, cyber experts, you're aware of those particular documents that help with risk mitigation. But I will say this, that we need to prepare that discussion to ensure that we are mitigating risk. Mitigate, mitigate, mitigate. The question is, are we resilient enough? I read an article on NPR that detailed out some sanctions they were talking about on Russia for attempting to hack certain critical infrastructure sectors. However, they were not successful per the actual article. I think HR 4298, which was introduced in the House in 2014, aimed to give the Federal Energy and Regulatory Commission, without notice, hearing, or report, power to effectively issue orders for emergency measures to protect either bulk power systems or the defense critical electric infrastructure whenever the president, who is currently right now President Donald Trump, issues a written direction or makes a determination. So I would say resilience should be evaluated based on a combination of a few factors: legal authorities codified into the law and actual implementation of those said measures deployed to mitigate those threats. So I'll say mitigate, mitigate, mitigate the risk that we have identified and moving forward. So with that said, what are you going to do about it? The only thing to do is answer America's call. Godspeed.